So hello and welcome to lecture number 9. Today we'll take the machinery we developed so far and apply it in what I call a case study, because in fact this is an application of the machinery developed so far that will show all the subtleties we talked about. And we'll talk about a very important object in quantum mechanics, the so-called momentum operator. So we put the machinery to work, and we will develop a little more machinery, but it's good to illustrate what we did so far abstractly in a concrete example. We consider the so-called momentum operator. And this momentum operator is an object we're going to call P, capital P, because it's the operator. It will have a domain, which we call curly D, P. And it will map in the full Hilbert space, of which this is to be a dense subset. And the complete Hilbert space is L2 of RD. But in our example here, we will specialize to D equals 1, because that shows the principle well enough. But in general, it's from dp to L2 rd. And what is this operator doing? It takes an element of L2 rd, or rather a suitable dense subset thereof, and maps it to minus I h bar del j. So that would be the jth momentum operator. That's the component of the momentum, the jth component, and it acts on psi. Okay, so this is what you will see in the quantum mechanics books as the momentum operator. Now the question is, why is this the momentum operator? Why does it look roughly like this? The answer is provided by a very deep theorem, is the Stone von Neumann theorem that says that up to unitary equivalence, this is unique. Says this is up to unitary equivalence the unique momentum operator in D spatial dimensions. So now I'm not talking about the dimensions of the Hilbert space, but the dimensions of the physical space, think of classical mechanics, in which the particle moves. So if D equals 1, we have a particle that moves only in one dimension. Okay, this will come later, because in order to even write down the assumptions of the Stone von Neumann theorem, we need the spectral theorem first. Okay, so this y, please take it on trust right now that this is an important operator in quantum mechanics, because it corresponds to the momentum observable in quantum mechanics. However, there is still an open question at this point, and that is how to choose the domain of this operator. Because, fair enough, you see, if you take square integrable functions, not every square integrable function can be differentiated. A square integrable function could have a jump in one point. It could be discontinuous. Well, if it's discontinuous, it cannot be derived. Hence, we must restrict this operator. Moreover, once we will be able to formulate the canonical commutation relations, we will see that we always need to go to an infinite dimensional Hilbert space, because this is an unbounded operator, and so on. But right now, what we do, we'll play the following game. We'll play the game that you will be confronted with over and over again. People will say, let's take this as the momentum operator, and they will not specify the domain on which it acts. But this is precisely where we come in, where we say we need to know this more precisely. What are possible domains? Now, you need to choose this domain such that the P is self-adjoint. So we want the P with the specifically chosen domain into this H. So I will only write this right-hand side as H from now on. We want this self-adjoint, because only then does it correspond to a quantum mechanical observable. But we saw that self-adjointness subtly depends on the choice of domain. So we could quickly come up with some guess of what the domain could be, such that this operation of differentiation can be executed, such that the result indeed is still square integrable. However, chances are low that we will immediately hit the right domain to make the self-adjoint. Okay? So I really want to go with you through this example without having things falling from the skies. Well, more or less not. Okay? So you see how to deal with this situation, and that will illustrate the formalism, hopefully, pretty well. Okay, so so that's the problem. Or rather, let's make this more interesting. Let's look at the momentum operator, not only in one dimension, which would be an infinite line, but let's rather look at the case where the physical space is just a compact interval. So you constrain your quantum particle to a little antenna or something like this. Let's say that's what happens. Versus, and we'll also look at a second non-trivial case, a quantum a particle on a circle, so a circular wire or something, if you manage to constrain your quantum particle to that. So you see, we don't need to rely on two standard assumptions. We are perfectly able to extend this formalism to any situation we might be interested in. So make the problem more interesting. Yeah? Make the problem even more interesting. By looking at, well, one-dimensional, for simplicity, one-dimensional physical spaces. That are non-trivial, that are not R itself, but rather an interval or this circle. Okay. Now, in both cases, however, in both cases, the big Hilbert space underlying it all is L2. Of this interval, after all. But the domain, but the initially reasonable domains for P will differ. So, on a compact interval, well, compact is just closed and finite here. On a compact interval, we will assume that the Hilbert space elements we look at, first of all, they need to be differentiable. But after we differentiate it, we still want them to be square integrable. Well, one way to ensure this is a good first guess, which we will probably have to refine, is that we take all once continuously differentiable functions on 0 to pi, because they are differentiable, and once you differentiate it, you get a continuous function, and a continuous function on a finite interval is certainly integrable. We saw that. But then there is this physical idea that if you have a particle that is here, that kind of this psi element, which is in the complex numbers, but that on the boundary points it vanishes, like you have a particle in a square well, and on the boundary, the probability beyond the boundary that the particle is there because it's an infinite well is zero, and the absolute value squared of the psi gives you that position probability. So you require, for physical reasons, you require that at that endpoint and at that endpoint, in both places, the psi vanishes. So this is with some physical idea behind it that you choose the d of p like this. However, on a circle, the situation is different. On a circle, you would choose psi, well, maybe still C1, 0, 2 pi, because that's not too bad. At least that doesn't violate any high school mathematical rules here. You will still require boundary conditions, but they're somewhat weaker, because all that you require is that if on the circle you go around with your psi, whatever values it takes, once you arrive here, it should coincide with the value at 0 degrees, right? So that is the cyclicity condition. So here at both endpoints it's zero, and here it's just that it's cyclic, that it's at all a function on the circle, okay? So these are two reasonable guesses to start with. They're not too silly. So you say, oh, maybe we're done. We meaningfully restricted this. We have this physical idea in there. We should be happy. Well, we're not quite happy, because what we need to check is whether the such defined piece, in the case of the interval of the circle, are indeed self-adjoint. That's what we need to check. Well, it will turn out neither of these is self-adjoint. One of them is not even essentially self-adjoint, but nevertheless has self-adjoint extensions, namely this one, but many. This one is already self-adjoint, so there is a unique essentially self-adjoint, and so there is a unique self-adjoint extension, and we'll determine them all. Okay, so this is really going to be concrete calculations today, and you will see that all these little theorems of inclusions and all of that will be important, and we'll use that. So today is a real quantum mechanics lecture. So I promise that nothing is going to fall from the sky. However, it's good to be educated, isn't it? So let me educate you first on a little piece of functional analysis, but really very briefly, namely section two, that's right, because I merged section one and two into one. Okay, so absolutely continuous functions, that's a certain function class, and so-called Sobolev spaces, and we'll actually only look at one Sobolev space. So we will naturally, in today's calculations, we will naturally meet or encounter the following spaces. Well, we already did encounter the idea that I take the C1 on a compact interval. But there will be another type of space we're interested in, and that's the so-called Sobolev space H1, also over a compact interval, and I'll define it in a second. And it's important that this space is a bigger space. It's an extension of the C1 space. And then we'll meet even a bigger extension. That's the space AC of the compact interval, and that's the so-called absolutely continuous functions. So these are the once continuously differentiable functions. This is called the so-called Sobolev space. And this is the space of absolutely continuous functions. And as you can imagine, if this guy is not self-adjoint, but if we find that it's symmetric, we know that the adjoint has a bigger domain, so naturally we will be led, always usually, be led to consider extensions of domains. And these are the extensions that will come up, so it's better to know them beforehand. Okay, so we have the following definition. A function f from a compact interval into the complex numbers is called absolutely continuous if there exists a function, well, let's call the function psi because that's the functions we're going to look at. If there exists a function rho on the same interval into the complex numbers that is integrable. Remember, measurable and the little extra condition is integrability, such that the psi, the function that's called absolutely continuous, can be written on the entire domain as the psi at the left point of the closed interval plus integral from a to x over rho t dt, or rho y dy if you want. Okay, so if a function psi can be written like this in terms of an integrable function rho, where this is a Lebesgue integral, and this of course means Lebesgue integrable, then the function psi is called absolutely continuous. That's the definition. And just as a piece of information, then it is true that rho is the derivative of psi. Rho is the derivative of psi, but not everywhere, but almost everywhere. The almost everywhere coming from the fact that we have a Lebesgue integral which doesn't care about what happens on the set of measure zero. And then we define the set AC, the set of absolutely continuous functions on an interval, a closed interval AB. For our purposes, it will be all the square integrable size. Well, they're square integrable in the first place. Anyway, all the square integrable size. So we wanted to look at one dimension such that psi is absolutely continuous. So it's just a collection of such functions. That's the AC set. And you wonder how one would be led to such a funny class of functions. Well, they play a huge role in Lebesgue theory, but they also appear naturally when we calculate today. So you will at some point say, aha, good that we know about this, good that we're educated about it. For instance, good that we know that they comprehend this space and this space comprehends that space. Okay. So because otherwise I would have to explain this in asides during our calculation, that wouldn't be particularly pedagogic. So we have this here. So that's the first definition of these absolutely continuous functions. And then we have the Sobolev space. So definition, the Sobolev space, H1 on the compact interval. It's again a function space, of course. And those are all the psi that are absolutely continuous. Aha, so you see whatever comes now as an extra condition, quite obviously this is a special case of those because those are the elements in the first place. And now we require that once we took the derivative, because we're in one dimension, instead of writing del sub 1, I write psi prime, that the result please be in L2 again. Okay, that's the Sobolev space. So there's nothing, there's a lot to be said about this. For instance, with a suitable inner product, this is a Hilbert space again, so you would know if something is defined on here, it's really defined on a sub-Hilbert space, stuff like that, okay? But we won't need all of that. It's just these spaces, these two, or rather these three spaces naturally appear in our study today. Hence I mentioned them. Okay? just for completeness. Okay, so let's see where we start. Let's start with the momentum operator on a closed interval. So let's focus on one case first. Operator on the closed, or hence on the compact interval. Compact is more precise because it's also finite. On a compact interval. And let's call this interval I, and just to be definite, let's say it starts at 0 and it ends at 2 pi. Obviously, that means that's not important what precisely that is. So now we consider, according to our initial considerations, an operator P from a domain dp into L2 of R, defined by psi being sent to minus I, well, h bar psi prime, but h bar is set to 1 everywhere, and dimensional analysis tells you where to reinsert them later on, okay? So I don't want to carry around these h bars all the time. So it's minus I times psi prime, but what we really need to specify for our case here is what this space is, and as we said before, for the compact interval, we take all the C1 functions on the interval with the additional constraint that psi of 2 pi is 0 and that psi of 0 is also 0, so that at the end points it vanishes. So we have a fully specified operator here. There's nothing to be desired as far as its definition is concerned. The big question for a quantum mechanical engineer, is this a self-adjoint operator? So the big question, before we can start doing quantum mechanics and think about physical implications, the big question is P defined as above, so including its domain, self-adjoint? So, let's pretend this is an exam question, and let's very systematically explore this. So the first thing, if you think back to lecture 7, is that if you know that an operator is symmetric on its domain, that you have rather more results on how it relates to its adjoint and to its closure and so on. You remember, some of these results came with the provision that the operator is symmetric. So the first thing we check is small I, is P symmetric? If it's not symmetric, you cannot make it self-adjoint, okay? Symmetry is a necessary condition for self-adjointness. What do you need to check for symmetry? For symmetry, you need to check that if you take two elements from the domain of the operator, it's very important to look at the domains here. So symmetry means you take two elements from the domain, then you need to check whether psi p phi is the same as p psi phi. So the question is this true? So let's evaluate this condition. Now, on this L2 space, the integral is, of course, the 0 to 2 pi, 0 to 2 pi dx psi bar of x. Now, the p is minus I phi prime. That's this side. And the other side is integral to 2 pi, 0 to 2 pi dx minus I psi prime of x, all barred, phi of x, right? So this is this here. Now it's easy to show that if you, for instance, move this prime over here, this is integral 0 to 2 pi dx. So we do an integration by parts. How does it work? Well, first of all, let's get rid of this minus I. It's barred, so it's actually an I. So it goes out as an I. But then, because you do an integration by parts, you pick up a minus 1, and you revolve this over here, so you get psi bar of x, phi prime of x. But what you must not forget in an integration of part is the boundary term. The boundary term is, well, you had an I coming out from here. The boundary term is, of course, psi bar of x, phi of x, from 0 to 2 pi. Now, you need to decide what this boundary term is. And this will again and again, so this type of calculation with differential operators will come up again and again, integration by parts. Don't jump to conclusions. Look very carefully. What are the objects in here? Well, psi and phi are both from the domain dp. But the domain dp has the elements coming with a boundary condition that at the endpoints the result is zero. So both the psi and the phi are all zero here and here. So certainly less would be sufficient to cross this out. But certainly this part here goes away. Okay? Now, once you saw this, you can pull this minus I into here under the big bar, but then, of course, it becomes a...
It's a plus I because you pull the minus I out and in the integration of parts, you get the minus before the integration.
No, hang on. I have a bar. The bar makes this to an I.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
So the I goes out, and then there's an integration by parts. I know, but it's okay because, of course, I don't want to pull it under here. I want to pull it into here to compare, right? Okay, fine. So this is correct. So indeed, yes, it is symmetric. Yes. So that's the first step that we completed. That's nice. So now let's calculate as the second step. If we want to find out whether the whole thing is self-adjoint, we need to check whether it coincides with its adjoint, correct? Meaning also the domain. So we need to calculate explicitly the adjoint. Calculate the adjoint P star. Aha. Before we start calculating adjoints, or adjoints of adjoints of adjoints, there's one thing you always do. You look at what you already know, because that will possibly be very important in your calculation. What we already know from step one is that the P is symmetric, right? And then we have a little theorem that says if P is symmetric, then the adjoint will certainly be an extension of the original operator, right? It's important to note this. Okay. Whether it will be important here, we'll see. But usually it's important to first write down what you know, and then you continue with the analysis. Now, the whole point of the adjoint, of the definition of the adjoint, is its domain. So in order to figure out what happens with the domain, you assume you take an element psi now from the domain of the adjoint. If you do that, then you know from the definition of the adjoint that for all phi in the domain of the original operator, it is true that psi, comma p acting on phi, that this equals the p star. Aha, yes, equals the p star. You know, I'm sorry, from the definition, you know there exists an eta in the Hilbert space, in our case L2, such that for all phi in the original domain, you have psi p phi equals eta comma phi, right? This is from the definition of the adjoint. Now, let's investigate this assumption here. So we keep all these quantors, but I will not repeat them again and again. So the condition, I write condition back there, is equivalent to the following: integral 0 to 2 pi dx psi bar of x minus I phi prime of x, that's just this side, equals integral 0 to 2 pi dx eta bar of x phi of x. Now this is tricky because we don't really know what to do with the eta. However, now one can always find a function capital N that's from a, b to c, and that's square integrable, such that the eta equals the derivative of the n almost everywhere. Okay, so that's a trick. So we would like to do an integration by parts argument here, but unfortunately on the right hand side there is no integration by parts possible because there's no derivative. So the idea is write this as a derivative. Now that's not so easy because the eta is supposed to be in L2. So you cannot always write down the derivative. However, you always find an absolutely continuous function such that the eta can be written as a derivative almost everywhere. Well, we don't want almost everywhere. We want everywhere. No, we don't, because the integral won't feel the difference. The Lebesgue integral won't feel the difference. So that's what we do here in order to proceed with the calculation, because otherwise, from this condition, I want to learn what follows from this condition that psi is in dp star. So let's proceed like this. So we have this n there. So it's always about rewriting the condition for psi being an element of that correct domain. So thus, I can continue here and I say since one can find, and then I can write here integral 0 to 2 pi dx n prime of x barred phi of x. But then we do integration by parts and we take both terms to the same side. So we start on the left, that's the dx. I write it like this. Dx psi bar of x minus I phi prime of x minus, so I take this part over here. But then I do an integration by parts, so it becomes a plus n bar of x phi prime of x, close bracket. But the integration of by parts on the right hand side, there remains a surface term on the right hand side, and that surface term is n bar of x phi of x from 0 to 2 pi. Agree? That's the surface term. Now the phi, let's go and see where the phi is from. Oh, the phi is from the domain of P, but the domain of P had these boundary conditions. About the domain of P star, we know nothing about boundary conditions. About this n, we know nothing about boundary conditions. But of this phi, we know it satisfies the boundary conditions because there's a phi of 2 pi, phi of 0, this whole term goes out. But only because of that, okay? So be very careful. Don't say, oh, we have boundary conditions and they apply to everything. No, they only apply to the objects from the domains where the boundary conditions apply, right? It's trivial, but one easily miscalculates that. Okay, so the left-hand side can be rewritten. This means this is the integral from 0 to 2 pi. Psi, there's a minus I in here, which I can put out, can take out to here. Then there is a minus I here. But then I have to put an I here in front to produce the plus sign again. But if I then put the I here underneath the bar, then it's like this. And because I want to put a big bar here, there is then psi minus I n. So psi of x minus I n of x, close bracket, everything barred, phi prime of x equals 0. And of course, this left-hand side is simply psi minus I n comma phi in a product, comma phi prime in a product, correct? So what do we conclude from this? Therefore, we conclude that the object psi minus I n, this function, is an element of the space of the orthogonal complement of all the phi primes. And where do the phi primes come from? Well, the phis all come from the DP domain, because that is what we have here. So we have this little result. This lies in this orthogonal complement. Now, why is this an interesting result? So at first you say, aha, so what? Well, you look at this sharply and you find, so we observation comes in two easy steps. The first observation is that the space of all the phi primes, where the phis come from DP, not the orthogonal complement now, but just this space, is the same space as all the continuous functions on the interval I, for which the integral from 0 to 2 pi psi of x dx vanishes. I claim this is the same space. And the second observation is, if I then take the closure of this space I just wrote down, that is just the orthogonal complement of the constant 1 function. 1 is the function that sends all psi's to 1. This is the constant 1 function. Okay, so, and we are, of course, going to prove that. So 1 takes any element in L2 of R to L2 of R and sends any psi to the constant, it takes all the elements in AB and sends them to the complex number 1. That's the 1 function, I'm sorry. Okay, it's the orthogonal complement of that. So why is this true? Proof. And once we have that, we can continue with this result, okay? So why is this true? So we have here an equality of sets. Of course, we prove an equality of sets by proving both inclusions in one direction and in the other direction. So let's assume you have a phi prime in here, okay? You have a phi prime in here. So let phi prime be in the set on the left-hand side. Okay, that's an element there. Then choose psi to be this phi prime, since then you can calculate 0 to pi. So it's the psi that's generated by this phi prime in a trivial way. Phi prime of x dx, which of course, by the fundamental theorem of calculus, which applies here, is phi of x in from 0 to 2 pi. But because the phi prime was there on the left-hand side set, the phi in particular is in dp. The dp has the boundary conditions. This equals 0, but this is precisely what this element needs to be. So that proves this inclusion. Now, the opposite inclusion is proven similarly, right? You take a psi out of the right-hand side set, okay? Set on the right-hand side. And then you take phi to be the integral. So you construct a phi in here. So this phi you construct it from the psi. You construct it at the point x as the integral from... Or did I say, The interval is from 0 to 2 pi, yes. I still had the interval from a to b in my mind, but we said from 0 to 2 pi. 0 to 2 pi of the psi of x dx. But what does then follow? Well, first of all, this phi xi, such constructed, is clearly in dp because it is once continuously differentiable. Because if you, this is y, and there is a y up here. I'm sorry. I want the x. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yes, x should be up here. I integrate over this. So then I differentiate with respect to x. I get the xi back. Okay. And the xi was continuous, so this is continuously differentiable. But we also have to check the boundary terms, and we have to check that phi constructed from xi at the position 2 pi goes from there to there. But because the xi is from the right-hand side, you know this integral is 0. And also you find if you evaluate at x equals 0, the integral domain is empty. So this yields 0 as well. So this in total means that the such constructed phi xi is an element of the set on the left-hand side, and that proves the other inclusion. It's very simple. So this is number one. So this proves number one. Number two is absolutely trivial. It just looks funny because you can clearly rewrite this condition here. You can rewrite it as the inner product from 1 with xi is 0, right? Of the 1 function, because I could include here a 1 of x bar, right? And then you have this guy here. And so 2 is the closure of the left-hand side is clearly the closure of the left-hand side is clearly the left-hand side orthogonal complement, okay. And that is, so that means that this set here is the orthogonal complement of the 1. I'm confused. Hang on a second. So I bar the right-hand side. Okay. So it's better. So that's true, but then it's of course the it's rather the bar of the right hand side. So the bar of the left hand side is the bar of the right hand side. So far, so trivial. But the right hand side is this xi in C0 of I, and here now comes a closed condition. So that means you bar this here. And this is a closed condition, and therefore, and the continuous functions are dense in L2. So this is actually then L2, okay? And so therefore, this is the orthogonal complement of the 1, because it's all those xi in L2 which have vanishing inner product with the 1, and we know that the complement of a set is always closed, in fact, so that coincides with this left-hand side being a closed set. All right, so that was this argument here. Now come our multiple orthogonal complements. Okay, so this is just these two observations which will now help us in interpreting this object. So, thus, we can proceed as follows. So we learned that psi minus in is in the orthogonal complement of these phi primes, where the phi's come from dp. That seems a rather abstract insight, but in fact it's a very simple insight, because this is a set and this is the orthogonal complement. We know that the set of that the orthogonal complement of a set, we know that if we then take the closure, nothing will happen because this is already closed. You remember? But then you can write this, I just write the set with three dots. You can write this as the orthogonal complement, and then the closure, you can write it as the double complement. You remember that as well? The closure as the double complement. But then if you write it as the double complement, you can rewrite it as the double complement, and only then you take again the complement. Whereas here that was the other way around. First one complement, then double complement. Right? But now you can write it like this. But that is, of course, the closure of the set orthogonal complement. Aha! But the closure of the set, we learned, is the orthogonal complement of the one function. So it's the double complement of the one function. So it's the closure of the one function. Well, this is also the span of the one function and whatnot. So what this is the set of all constant functions. All functions c, a, b to c, well, where x is sent to a number, to a constant c. Okay? Ah! So if psi minus in is in the set of constant functions, that means, very profanely, it means that psi of x minus in of x equals a constant. Aha, okay. So that looks much more friendly than this insight here. Okay? So this is something you can calculate with. This is a constant. Mm-hmm. Aha. So we really learned something. Ah. Yes. Yes. But therefore it follows, I'm sorry, I was, my notes were wrong. So therefore I know that psi of x equals a constant plus, and the n was an absolutely continuous function, you remember? Plus plus I n of x, but this guy was an absolutely continuous function, so could be written as an integral constant plus something, which means that the whole psi is an absolutely continuous function on our interval. Okay. Thus, we started with psi, assume it's in the domain of the adjoint, and what we concluded is that psi is an element of the absolutely continuous functions. So what we thereby concluded is that dp star is in what relation to ACI?
Well, it's included.
It's included, that's it. So you cannot conclude more than that this inclusion holds. Okay? It's certainly in there. Now we need something more. We need, if we look at the adjoint here, we need that the result lies in L2 of R. And thus, we need to require that minus I psi prime of such a psi in here be an element in L2 of R again. But in order for that to hold, if the psi is in ACI and its derivative is in L2 of R, then psi is in what we called H1 AB. So that means psi is a Sobolev function. However, the question is it all the Sobolev functions? So you have so far dp star contained in H1, so it's a sharpening of the previous result. So we have this. The question is this entire space, does it assume, is equality assumed? And in fact, equality is assumed because all the manipulations we made, in particular, if you now calculated the condition for the adjoint, all the manipulations we made in particular, and that's actually the only manipulation we made, the integration by parts works for Sobolev functions. The integration by parts does not work for L2 functions because they're not even differentiable. But for Sobolev functions, it works. Since the previously executed integrations by part or by parts work with any Sobolev function psi in H1 of I, we have in fact, so you need to go back and check that, we have in fact that the domain of this is indeed H1 of I, no further constraints, and the P star therefore goes from H1 of I to L2 of R, and for the same reason that these integrations by part work, the prescription for how you construct the P star, the extension, also on the extended domain works like this. So note, as expected, and by expected I mean as we noted in the beginning, so the expectation was that whatever happens, the P star will be an extension. As expected, the domain of P star is indeed an extension of the domain of P. Right? Because the domain of P were C1 functions with an extra condition. And the H1 functions are even comprehending the space C1 without extra condition. Much more do they comprehend the space C1 with an extra condition. Okay, so this is a little check on that expectation. And we indeed calculated the adjoint. So the P was defined on C1 with the boundary condition. The P star is defined on H1. And in fact, it's not only an inclusion like this, it's an inclusion of which we can now positively claim it's a true extension. Equality is not assumed. H1 is bigger than C1. So certainly also bigger than C1 with a boundary condition. So the P star, the adjoint, is an extension, and it's in fact not the same. So result, P, as we defined in the beginning, is not self-adjoint. Okay? So let's pause here for a moment. And apart from the details of the calculation, which I'm sure if you look at this twice or three times, you'll say, aha, this is really quite obvious how this works. And we'll do a few more of such calculations so you will see it's always the same. So somebody came and provided us with a momentum operator, prescription minus I times the derivative acting on the psi. and didn't specify the domain. We say, well, domain issues are subtle. Let's specify a domain that makes sense in the first place. But the domain we wrote down that makes sense, that makes everything defined, however, turns out such that the adjoint has a bigger domain than the domain we just guessed. This will be the standard case. You do something reasonable, but you don't exactly hit the maximal domain you want. Okay? So, okay, unfortunately, you wanted to provide the domain. You did provide a reasonable domain. It's a good domain. Everything is well defined, but the operator is not self-adjoint. So you're not finished yet. You haven't managed yet to show or to write down the precise momentum operator of quantum mechanics on a compact interval. You're not there yet. Aha. But if the operator is not self-adjoint, what could be the case? Well, it could be the case, remember lecture 7, that maybe it's essentially self-adjoint. What does that mean? Well, essentially self-adjoint means that it's double dual, the closure, not dual, double adjoint, also called the closure, is adjoint, a self-adjoint. If it is, then we know, everything is fine because we have the theorem. If the closure is self-adjoint, then the closure is the unique self-adjoint extension. So then you simply take the closure instead of the original operator and you're done. You have a self-adjoint operator. And you know that's unique and all of that. Okay? So if this P is not self-adjoint, let's try to calculate the double adjoint, the closure, and let's see whether that is self-adjoint. That's the natural next step. Otherwise, we'd be finished. Okay? So what should be noted from this first, as a result for the further discussion, you need to keep this in mind. Well, and this is then automatic. Okay? So this needs to be kept in mind because that may come in useful now. So we're not finished yet. So let's do step 3. Calculate, because that's your next best hope, calculate the closure, P star star of P. And you know that some people, instead of P star star, write P bar. But let's keep it with the star star here for the time being, okay? Calculate the closure, P star star. Now, know. What do we know? Well, first of all, we know that P is symmetric. We still know this from number 1, right? P is symmetric. And then we had this nice little theorem that if P is symmetric, then P is extended by P star star, which in turn is extended by P star. So we had this theorem, if P is already symmetric, then certainly the closure lies between the adjoint and the operator. That we already know. So if you already know it, why shouldn't we write it down? Okay. Okay, and we know one more thing. We also know that the P star star is also symmetric. Huh? So if the P is symmetric, you do not know that the P star is symmetric. You do not. But if the P is symmetric, you know the P star star is again symmetric. I think we remarked that. So these are things you already know. And then we simply evaluate again what it means to have an element psi now in the domain of the operator we're looking at. So don't be confused. I again and again called this the psi. Well, in part 2, the psi was an element of dp star. Now in part 3, the psi is an element of dp star star. I just do this always according to the definition of the domain. We have this. We know if this is the case, then for all phi that lie in dp star, now I don't work with the eta anymore because I can write down immediately what this is. This is psi, comma, P star acting on the phi equals, well, if the psi is in the P star star domain, I can certainly write P star star psi, comma phi, because I could go via the eta and then redefine the eta as this, but this is certainly true. Agree? And now comes a standard trick, and that's why I say you must always write down what you already know. Normally, you wouldn't know what to do. You say, okay, what does it help me? I don't know what this object is because I'm just about to calculate it, right? But look what you already know. You know in particular this. You know that the P star star you're about to calculate is extended by the P star. Do you remember what the symbol means, this extension? This extension means two things. It means that the domain of the dP star star is contained in the domain of the dP star. But even better, you know that the P star star acting on a psi is the same as the P star acting on the psi, because this is true for all the psi in the smaller domain. In the domain where they coincide, you could use either or the other operator. Now, on which size does this P star star act? It acts on this domain. This domain is the smaller one, so I can simply act on the same size, so I don't change where psi comes from. I can act on it with the P star instead, because on that common part of the domain, it is the P star action. Okay? You see how important that is to note what you already learned, because now you have a P star on the left and you have a P star on the right, and you already calculated P star before. You already know what the P star is. You say, oh, but then it's probably trivial. No, it isn't. Because look, it would only be trivial if you knew that the P star is symmetric because it jumped from here to here for all guys in the domain of the P star, which is bigger than the other one. You don't know whether it's symmetric. So let's carefully evaluate what this condition means. Don't be discouraged when you see this. You need to look very carefully what the condition means. So thus, so I repeat here, for all psi in dP star star and for all phi in dP star, we have integral 0 to pi psi bar of x minus I phi prime of x. Why? Well, because the P star still acts as this operator, just on this bigger domain. Excellent. So it does that. Equals integral 2 pi, now it acts on here, but we know that works, minus I psi prime bar of x, phi of x, and the bar is here. So at first this looks a little boring, but let's see what really happens. So we again have this, well, there's a dx missing everywhere. We have the dx, we have the psi bar of x minus I phi prime of x, and you take this to the other side, and blah, 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 and you get a plus. Well, let's do it. So you take an I out, but then you do an integration by parts, so it becomes a minus I again, which goes over there, and then you take it to the other side, so you have a minus psi bar of x minus I phi prime of x. Okay, you have this, so this cancels. So what remains on the right hand side is the surface term. The surface term is an I, because this goes out, psi of x, phi of x in the boundary from 0 to 2 pi. But now let's be careful. The phi is now in the P star domain. So the phi comes from the P star domain, but the P star domain is simply the Sobolev space. There is no talk about boundary conditions whatsoever. Right. So therefore, the whole thing equals, I'm sorry, this equals this, then this whole thing equals zero. So zero equals, the I is irrelevant, psi of 2 pi, bar even, phi of 2 pi minus psi bar of 0, phi of 0 must be 0. But the phis that come from the Sobolev space, you know nothing about the values of the phi at the endpoints. There is no condition on the endpoints. These guys are arbitrary. This guy is arbitrary, and this guy is independently arbitrary. Well, there's only one conclusion from that. The conclusion is psi of 2 pi must be 0, and psi of 0 must also be 0 in order to satisfy this condition. What condition is this? This is the condition that the psi is in dp star star, right? Now, in here, we could have extended the psi, which in fact comes from the dp star star, we could have extended this up to the p star, right? Because this would still legally act, but not further. So we could have extended this up to here, but now we see we can't really. We see the psi, therefore, must come from the set of all theta, say, of dp star, that's the maximal possible extension by our extension observation there, but we have to have that psi of 2 pi equals 0 equals psi of 0. But this is, of course, the same space as theta in H1 of I, because that's the dp star, but now with an extra condition. Psi of 2 pi equals 0 equals psi of 0. Okay? And that's the maximal extension that's possible. Hence, we learn that dp star star equals, well, there's no easier way to write it. It's this H1 space with the additional condition. Oh, now I wrote it down three times. Okay. That's the dp star star. And because clearly this is contained still and is not equal to dp star because there's an extra condition, still it's the same definition of the map, of the actual, the prescription of the map. Okay? So we can summarize so far. There's always the same kind of trick, and it's usually about domains and boundary conditions, at least if you talk about a differential operator, like you meet them very often in quantum mechanics here. So summary so far. We have our P that goes from C1 of I write this a little shorter here, right? With the extra condition that, well, you always got to pay if you don't follow the formalism. So it goes from here, where psi of 0 equals 0 is psi of 2 pi. It goes into the L2 of R, and it's simply given by psi is mapped to minus I psi prime. That's the P operator. The P star operator we found goes from H1 I, so the Sobolev functions, into L2 of R. And again, the prescription, even on this bigger space, you see this space is bigger than that space, right? Because H1 is already bigger than C1. It's even bigger than C1 with an extra condition. But still, the prescription here is the same. And finally, the double adjoint, or the closure as it is called, well, that's again psi in H1 of I. Now, that is not this entire space, it's this space again with this type of restriction into L2 of R. Psi is still being mapped to minus I psi prime. And again, now, this space, however, lies in this one, but it's bigger than that one. So indeed, right, we get P lies in P star star, lies in P star. Well, we knew this before we calculated the closure because the P is symmetric. But what we learned is that this guy is not equal and this guy is not equal either. You see that? It's simply not equal. So we learned more from our explicit calculation. We saw that none of the equalities is assumed. None of them is assumed. But you would need that at least this one is assumed in order to take the star again to go the other way around and find self-adjointness. So if you think about this, P is not self-adjoint. Well, that we knew before. And that's the point, not even essentially self-adjoint. And that has to do with this guy here. Aha. Oh. That looks bad, because if it's not even essentially self-adjoint, then there may be self-adjoint extensions. So it doesn't mean you cannot do, you cannot have momentum. You cannot measure momentum on a compact interval, but you probably have to make a choice under many possibilities. In fact, there is an uncountable ambiguity, but there could be the nasty case where you can't measure momentum at all on the compact interval. And how would you check that? How would you check that there is at least some self-adjoint extension, even if it's not unique? Defect indices. So let's calculate the defect indices. Okay. I mean, this is innocent. You see, this is what people tell you. Let's do quantum mechanics in an infinite square well, right? Let's have the wave function, the psi, vanish at the boundaries, and that's an easy problem, right? This is first quantum mechanics class in wherever you do that, right? it's very complicated, right? I mean, this is not easy at all, okay? So you see, we've been, with all our machinery, we've been struggling now for 1 hour, 15 minutes, and we still haven't written down a momentum operator for this so-called simple elementary problem. We will be satisfied with the circle. Everything is nice on the circle. Okay, so where are we? Number, what is it, 5, 4? Where were we? 4, no? Calculate the deficient defect indices. Defect indices. Aha. So how did this work? So the defect indices, so we again collect what we know. Well, I think everything is on the right blackboard. Recall that we had two defect indices, D plus and D minus, and they're defined as the dimension of the kernel of the adjoint of the operator minus I and the dimension of the kernel of the adjoint operator plus the I. Okay? Okay. So we need to figure out how many linearly independent, hence dimension, how many linearly independent psi's lie in the kernel of this guy. So, but what are the psi's that you look at in the first place? So determine how many linearly independent size, well, they must be in the domain of P star. Where else would I take them from if the P star appears? Determine how many linearly independent psi in dP star lie in, well, the kernel of P star minus or plus I respectively. So we do both cases at the same time. Well, what are the elements in here? So psi in there is the same as saying p psi minus plus I, two cases at once, psi equals 0, right? That's the size in the kernel are defined by this. But what is this p star on the size in the p domain of p star? Remember, the domain of p star for the closed interval was the Sobolev space. Aha. So, and on there, this is defined as minus I psi prime minus plus I psi, equals 0. Well, obviously, I can divide on both sides by minus I. So the condition is psi prime plus minus psi equals 0. Well, that is not too difficult to solve in two dimensions. In here, you can differentiate, blah, blah, blah. Therefore, we have psi of x equals a plus minus, it depends on what case you look at, e to the minus. Okay, so if the upper, we have the upper sign, then we need to produce a minus sign. The lower sign, we need to produce a sign like this. We have something like this. No, we have exactly like this. For some a plus, a minus, arbitrary in the complex numbers, right? Aha. So that means in each case, we have a one-dimensional space because the a is just the factor, the coefficients. We have e to the minus x and e to the plus x as the only solutions, right? So therefore, d plus is 1 and d minus is 1. And the most important thing is they're equal. And what does the theorem say? If they're equal, then it means there exists a self-adjoint extension of the original operator. Aha. So that means we're not really lost. One can extend this operator to a self-adjoint operator on a compact interval. And it turns out there is a U1 ambiguity, so you have a continuum of possibilities. We're not following this further at this point because the techniques we develop go that far. You know, okay, you can do it. Okay, so you can tell the guy what you did, you can do it, but don't you think you specified already everything? You didn't specify the momentum operator yet, right? The guy who wrote it down without the domain specification. You say, of what you started, one can make something out of it. You can do momentum measurements on the compact interval, but don't you think it's simple? And don't you think you already made the choice completely? Okay? If you do the same thing on a half line, so just from 0 to infinity, a half line instead of a compact interval, there is no momentum operator. I think you get 1 and 0 as the defect indices. So on a half line, you can have quantum mechanics on a half line, but momentum is not defined. There is no notion of momentum on a half line in quantum mechanics because they're simply for the operator you write down, and the Stone von Neumann theorem tells you it's the only operator you can write down for the momentum, right? There is no momentum on a half line. Okay, so let's go to the circle. Well, are there questions so far? I mean, this was really a mean example because really nothing worked out up to the very end where you say, okay, something can be done. But that's precisely why I chose the example, to show you how far you must push the analysis with the tools we have. If I had provided you more tools, in particular Cayley transforms and so on, we could have gone further here and I could have classified all the possible self-adjoint extensions, but we're not going to need that. And if you want to look at that, you go to the literature and you find it. Okay, Cayley transforms is the keyword. And that's actually the technique behind the proof of the theorem that tells you that if and only if the defect indices coincide, there are self-adjoint extensions in the first place. And you remember I gave this theorem without proof, but you're certainly prepared to understand the proof and the necessary background in 2 or 3 hours if you put your mind to it. Okay, so I'm just not doing it because we can't do all in these lectures, but you're fully prepared to understand. Okay, so now, therefore, let's do something that satisfies us a little more. Let's look at the momentum operator on a circle. So again, we start like we started before. However, now, so although I use the same symbols, don't be confused. Now the momentum operator goes again from a domain I call dp, and I again go to this 0 to pi, so I can write this interval here. But now the dp is given slightly differently. It's all the once continuously differentiable functions on this interval. But now in order to take this interval and bend it into a circle, in a process something like this, I can do this by requiring that once I arrived at 2 pi, the function takes the same value it had here. And then, of course, you have something like a function on the circle. You understand the idea? Right. Okay, so there's a subtle difference because before we had this equals 0 and this equals 0, and now they only equal each other but no longer equal to 0. Okay, so it's clear. So again, the psi is supposed to be the minus I psi prime. And we note immediately that the p on the circle is an extension of the p on the interval because this condition is not as restrictive as asking that both are zero. So this is clearly an extension of the p on the interval. Okay. So we can check symmetry of P, and the answer will again be yes, but now you see before we had something like psi phi 0 to pi. It was 0 because every single term was 0, but now it will be 0, not because every single term is 0, but because psi of 2 pi, phi of 2 pi minus psi of 0, pi of phi of 0, they're the same terms, and so they cancel each other. So they're again 0, but for different reasons, still because of the boundary conditions, but not exactly the same way because of the boundary conditions, but nevertheless, the p on the circle, so this is the p on the circle, I just don't write this all the time, the p on the circle is also symmetric. Okay, so that's good news, so and not difficult to calculate. So now we want to know whether the whole thing is self-adjoint, so we need to calculate the adjoint. We need to calculate the adjoint P star. Aha. So what do we know already? Well, I would like to use this because we already did a number of calculations. And if I already know this, why would I not use it? Okay. So I know the following thing. I know that P is certainly extended by P star because of number one. But however, I also know something different. I know that the p interval lies in the p circle, and that means if I take the dual on both sides, this inclusion reverses, remember? So I know that p circle, that's the p we're talking about, adjoint, I always say dual, but I mean adjoint, p star adjoint now lies in the p interval, P interval, so I only write here P interval, star. And that means, of course, in particular, that the dP star we want to calculate lies in the domain of the dP star interval, but we know what the domain of the dP star interval was. It was the H1 space, you remember? So we already know that dP star lies in the H1 space. And that we will be able to use. So how do we do this? Well, as always, so what do you guess what we check? Well, we take a psi in the domain of the adjoint operator we want to calculate. Okay, and then we know if this is true, so let, then we know that for all phi in the domain of the original operator, we have psi pi phi equals p star on psi comma phi. Okay, and that's the p star of the circle operator, of course. But now we know that the P star interval operator is an extension of the P star of the circle operator. Hence, we can certainly, on the smaller domain of this guy, which we need, we can certainly let this guy act because we already know how it works. Okay? So we can clearly replace this by P star interval. We're just making the best use of what we already calculated, right? So again, by an extension argument, right? I already gave it since the P star is extended by the P interval star, I can do this. But the P interval star I know intimately well because I know H1 is the domain. I know it acts still by minus I derivative. So I can write down what this whole thing means. So I can write down this here means integral 0 to 2 pi dx psi bar of x minus I phi prime of x equals. Now the right hand side 0 to 2 pi dx. Now this guy I now know because I know the P star interval is minus I psi prime of x all barred phi of x. Okay, you already guessed it. We again do the integration by parts and so on. So equivalent to 0 to 2 pi. And you also guess it, blah, 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 blah. Pushing this over here will again result in these guys canceling, okay? So we have 0 equals, 0 equals, and then here we only are left with the I that pulls out here, and then the surface term of psi bar of x, phi of x, in the domain of 0 to 2 pi. And the right-hand side, therefore, is 0. Looks the same old thing again, but this time it's still a little different from before. Because now where do the phi, does the phi come from? The phi comes from the dP domain. The dP now domain is now this one where the values at the endpoints coincide, but they're not both zero. So I cannot drop this term because at the endpoints the phi would be zero because it isn't. The psi bar, the psi comes from the dP star domain, which we don't know yet. We only know it lies in the H1 domain. It can never be bigger than the H1, right? But the H1 tells us nothing about boundaries, values at the boundary. Meaning this term simply does not vanish. However, what we can do, I can write I, and I use that at 2 pi, this object is the same as at 0. I twice use the value at 0, and it here I have psi bar of 2 pi minus psi bar of 0. because there's actually a phi of 2 pi in front of here, but that's the same as the phi of 0. So I have this. But otherwise, the phi of 0 is arbitrary. There's nothing be said what the phi of 0 would be. Okay. Hence, it follows that psi of 2 pi must be psi of 0. But with now again the same argument, with that provision, because this guy extends this, I can extend the domain of the psi as much as until I hit the wall for this operator, because I know it must lie certainly in here, but I can extend it up to here, up to the H1, but I still have to impose this. Therefore, the domain dp star we're looking for is all the psi's in H1, but not all of them, only those that satisfy this condition. Psi 2 pi is psi of 0. Ah, so we found the domain, and you see, again, it's different from before. This is the dp circle, p circle star, is not H1 like the dp interval star, it's the H1 with this cyclic boundary condition. Okay? Every case is slightly different, and you see, you cannot say, oh, I know it in the interval, so I know it on the circle. You really have to evaluate each time, but you see, it's always the same type of calculation. Okay, so we have this thing, and of course we can extend up to here on all of this H1. It would be given by this action, the P star operator. Well, certainly it's then given on this. So we know P circle star goes from H1 of I restricted to B. I'm now a little bit nonchalant with the domain names. To here, and still psi is being mapped to minus I psi prime. So you see, if you're not interested in the domains, you say, well, it's always the same operator. Yeah, but you need to know what domain, otherwise you're lost, okay? So this is the intermediate result. We calculated this guy, and of course, you again see that this is true, because the domain of P is the C1 with that boundary condition. The domain of P star is the H1, which is bigger than the C1, with the same boundary condition. Still, it's the bigger space. Still, this extension is valid. And of course, it must. We knew this abstractly, but now we know the concrete spaces, not only relations between spaces, but the concrete spaces. Aha, but is the whole thing self-adjoint? Is the P self-adjoint? Yes or no? Yes? Who says yes? Well, but didn't we just say that the dp is the same thing only with a C1 here? And then the same condition? And isn't H1 more than C1? It is. So in fact, it's a true extension. That means P star is an extension, but it's a true extension, meaning in particular, P is not self-adjoint. Aha. Whew. Maybe it's essentially self-adjoint. What's the number? 4?
5.
Okay, so maybe P is essentially self-adjoint. What does that mean? It means that the closure is self-adjoint, right? Well, before we can check this, well, no, that was just a sentence. Well, in order to check this, let's calculate 5, calculate the closure. Calculate the closure. P star star, now of course of the circle P. All right, what do we know? We know that P is symmetric. Hence, we know P is extended by P star star is expanded by P star, all for the circle P. Okay? We already know the domains here. We know this is defined on C1. I say C1 cyclic. Okay? C1 with the cyclicity condition, psi of 2 pi is psi of 0. We know that this guy is defined on H1 cyclic, don't we? Yes, we know that. I need to calculate this guy. How do we do this? Okay. How do we do it? We take a psi in the domain of the operator we want to calculate. If I know this, let me see what's the strategy here. Yeah, it's the same old thing. Okay. So then for all the phi in the domain of the operator without the additional star, we know psi p star phi is p star star psi comma phi. Aha. Now we're using this guy here. We know that the p star, which we already calculated, extends this guy. So I know, because of this here, I know that this can be replaced by p star psi on the entire domain of the psi, because it's the smaller domain. Okay? Again, it looks like a symmetry condition. We don't really know it's symmetric. We write down the integrals on the left-hand side, 0 to pi, and the right-hand side, 0 to pi. We have here some issue with these guys canceling again because of the integration by parts, and what remains on the right-hand side is a boundary term. An I goes out, and the boundary term must be psi bar of x, phi of x, in the domain 0 to 2 pi. Okay? So you agree this will be exactly the same thing. We write down all these guys, blah, blah, blah. We take this to the other side. All that can remain is the boundary term on the right-hand side, which in this case looks like that. Now let me see whether this is what I calculated at home. Yes. Little surprise. Okay, so we have this. Now let's see where the objects come from. The phi comes from the dp star. The dp star is the h1 cyclic, so we know that the phi of 2 pi is the phi of 0. Okay, so we have here, so this side is 0 equals I, and now I take the phi of 0 out again, as before. I have the psi pi, psi bar of 2 pi minus psi bar of 0, as before. And yet again, I must conclude that psi of 2 pi equals psi of 0. Aha. But up to where could I have extended this domain? Well, because of the application of this guy up to the H1 cyclic. But this is the cyclicity condition. So that means this could be extended up to the H1 cyclic if I impose the cyclicity condition. Well, that's nothing new. That means the dp star star is also the H1 cyclic, which is the dp star equal the dp star. Aha! So therefore, p star star, because also I can extend it, and this is also the minus I derivative operator on all of there, p star star is p star. Well, if you have that, you can equally conclude, if you take then another star on both sides, you get p triple star equals p star star. Ah, p triple star equals p star star means, so this is equivalent, means the p, the underlying p, is essentially self-adjoint. Ah, hallelujah. Okay, so here we don't have to go any further. We started with a domain that wasn't quite it, because the operator was not self-adjoint on the domain. But here we just, by always doing the same type of calculation, using what we already know by the few little lemmata I gave you, we arrived at the insight that P is essentially self-adjoint. And even more, we know precisely how this P star star looks like. We know its domain, H1 cyclic, and we know it still acts as the derivative operator. Aha, good. So our initial guess, P circle, was not a self-adjoint operator, hence could not be the momentum operator on the circle. It's not self-adjoint. It's not an observable. It's useless for quantum mechanics. But instead, we replace it by its closure, because the closure is self-adjoint. And we know if we have found one self-adjoint extension, there is no bigger one, right? We proved that too. So we're at the end of the journey. So result, we succeeded in constructing the momentum, and it's not a, but it's the momentum operator on a circle, because we take the closure P star star of our initial, well, you must say initial guess, because I mean, we just guessed a domain on which at least the objects are defined, right? It maps from the right set into the right set, but we take the closure of our initial guess. And so I say P, I call it PS1, it's the P on the circle, so the true momentum operator is this one. It goes from H1 cyclic, right? It goes from H1 cyclic, meaning the H1 with this condition psi of 2 pi is psi of 0, into L2, not of R. I sometimes wrote L2 of R. Please everywhere replace L2 of I. Even for the circle, it's L2 of I. And the psi is, by the mere prescription of it, looks familiar. But this is the right momentum operator on the circle, and it's the unique such choice. Okay, so you need this cyclic Sobolev space. Okay, so this was quite a tour de force through these calculations, but I also wanted to show you it's always the same rhythm. So please study this in detail in order to get the gist of it. But I hope you also see that the little theorems with these inclusions, once you know them, it's always the application of the definition of the domain of the adjoint operator, or the adjoint of the adjoint of the adjoint, and so on. Okay, it's only that formula, and it's the little theorems we had about the inclusions, and then you should be set. And then for these differential operators where the inner product is given by an integral, well, you always need to use integration by parts, and it's always the boundary terms you have to be very careful with, and you go from case to case. Now again, the only, I mentioned in the beginning, but maybe I should mention it again, so we started from this, we took this as granted, that at least on some domain it should look like this prescription. From that, even starting with a domain that was not making things ill-defined, but that was not the domain on which it's self-adjoint, so we can start with some domain that works. That's easy enough to guess. And then this procedure gets you to the domain where it works. Unless you have the unfortunate case that the extension is not unique, as we had for the compact interval. So this is under control. And this is the principle what you need to do if people tell you an operator is defined like this. You need to be careful about these domains. Okay? Now, I mentioned in the beginning, but why do we start with such a funny map? Why do I take the psi to minus I? Well, don't mind the minus I, although it's very important. why do I take the derivative here? What is that? Okay, and I said that's the stone for Neumann theorem. So let me call that an outlook. Okay. Well, if I say momentum, you have, of course, an idea from classical mechanics what a momentum is. And in classical mechanics, the relation between position and momentum in the ith position and the jth momentum, so these are covector components, these are coordinates on a manifold, that's why the index is up, down, you know that this is delta ij, these are the canonical commutation relations. Well, at least the bracket is built in such a way that this is delta ij. You saw this, right? These are the canonical Poisson brackets. It's the Poisson brackets in classical mechanics. Now, in quantum mechanics, but everything I'm going to write down now is illegal, although you see it very often. In quantum mechanics, you want to replace this by the commutator of two self-adjoint operators. Now, you can quickly check, because the product, even if A, B are bounded, you know that the adjoint, I think you calculated this on one of the problem sheets, that if there's a composition, that you have this inversion of the order, right? And you also have that if you have a complex number lambda, and do this, you get lambda bar A star. But this is only for A, B bounded operators. It turns out the Qs and the Ps in quantum mechanics, like this P, is an unbounded operator. What I want to say is, first of all, if they were bounded, you would see I need to get an I and a J, you get the delta ij, but you get an identity on the Hilbert space on which this acts, or rather on the common domain of the two, P intersected Q. And there must also be an I here, because of this inversion, you need an I to go to the minus I so that the right-hand side is an observable again. No, that's not true. It's not an observable. It's so that's not inconsistent from the beginning. Okay, so it would be inconsistent if you didn't put an I here. So, but other than that, this simulates this, and this process to go from here to here to say we want to replace these classical observables satisfying Poisson brackets, we want to replace it by such commutation relations for the self-adjoint operators, this is called a quantization prescription. You say if anything is quantum mechanically a position and momentum operator, it should better satisfy such a relation. Now, this is mere intuition, one must say. Okay, there are many points to be made for that, like Ehrenfest theorem that tells you that the expectation values of this then behave like this and so. So it's not unreasonable, and it's in fact what one needs to do. But there are many, many problems with this. For instance, the Q and the P, they're unbounded operators, and you cannot even write these commutation relations. You either have to use projectors of these guys, or you have to use them in exponentiated form. We will need to do all of this. But in order to do this, we need a spectral theorem, right? I would have loved to motivate this today, but I can only write down magical arguments, right? None of these would be solid. So I rather wait until I have the spectral theorem, and then I can write down commutation relations. And then, starting from here, from this assumption, the Stone von Neumann theorem that I mentioned in the beginning tells you, up to unitary transformations, the Q acting on a psi must be given as x times psi of x, and the P acting on the psi, the result must be minus I psi prime of x. Up to unitary transformations, this is true, but the unitary transformations don't make a difference. Okay? And so you see, if you come from here, if we could do this, in order to do this right, we need the spectral theorem, and then we can show the Stone von Neumann theorem, and then we'll find that this is precisely what you need. Well, then you still don't know how to choose the domain here in various cases, but then you have the starting point I chose today in order to make you familiar with the formalism. Okay, so please take it on trust that the little cloud is very reasonable. It's even more than reasonable. It's the result of a uniqueness theorem, which we're going to do. Okay? Thank you. See you tomorrow.